Little City. I have seen the end of days. And years from now, men will say, here began the fall of Rome. From the many and given to the few. Those who wore the golden wreath grew sick with every kind of wickedness. They were filled with greed, deceit, and malice. They condemned and enslaved. Friends and murdered those they loved. They did all this and called it just. And I saw in his hand a book sealed with seven seals, the first of which was broken. Behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and he went forth to conquer. Filled with smoke and blood.
Hello everyone, this is General Odom. Welcome to our Let's Play Total War Attila series. So we will be playing the Grand Campaign as the Western Roman Empire, but you'll see that there are barbarian kingdoms here, the Franks, the Saxons, and then the Great Migration, the Great Migrators, the Ostrogoths, the Alans, the Vandals, and the Visigoths, and then we also have nomadic tribes, which will be the Huns, led by Uldan. So this will be the terror that, or the scourge of the earth that comes in, destroys everything. We have the Roman Empire over here, the Eastern Roman Empire led by Flavius Arcadius Augustus, and then we have the Western Roman Empire led by Flavius Honorius Augustus. So I believe they are probably brothers? Not sure. The Western Empire is on the very edge of catastrophe. Its emperor dances to the tune of a half-Vandal general. Its powerless senators idle on vast, poorly managed estates. Since the Empire's division, the flaws besetting the West have rapidly become apparent. There is neither the manpower or the gold needed for an effective army, leaving it unable to deal with the many displaced barbarians pouring across Rome's borders ahead of the Hunnic horde. Roman empires have become increasingly fragile. Many are manipulated by generals or disposed by their meddling eastern counterparts. Nonetheless, it is still possible for the Western Empire to rise again. Times of crisis create opportunities which, if seized upon, will see the empire reforged and revitalized. So this is what our objective is, to reclaim the glory that was once the Roman Empire. First by replenishing our forces, revitalizing the economy, and doing all the things we need in order to defeat what is slowly the corruption that is destroying the Roman Empire, and then the external threat of the barbarians and the Huns. But let's take a look at the Eastern Empires. The Sassanid Empire in the east, led by Bahram. And then we have the Norsemen, we have the Jutes, the Danes, and the Geats. Alright, so let us look at the Eastern Roman Empire really quick. I'm just gonna scroll down here, and you guys can read it if you wish. But we will take a look at the traits that we have. Imperial allegiance, the benefits of empire hold a certain appeal, especially to the outside observer. Can levy units from friendly hordes passing through Roman territory. So we can recruit migratory hordes that come by that are friendly. Fantastic. And cultural integration. Men are men, no matter their origin. Upkeep costs -2% per non-Roman unit in a military force. And constant immigration. Immigration public order penalties -50%. So there will be a whole ton of public order issues. So right now there is normal, easy, hard, very hard, and legendary. I think I'm gonna go with hard. I feel like very hard might not be very fun, and to be honest, we're really here just to have fun and also have a little bit of a challenge. That's why we're not playing easy or normal. Minor victory, survive until the following date, spring 425. That is our objective, to survive. Control 80 settlements either by direct ownership or through satrapies and military allies. Maintain control of the following 3 provinces either by direct ownership or through puppet states and military allies. Italia, Liguria, Venetia. Research 10 technologies, produce the following amount of wealth from all buildings. 25,000 denarii. Maintain 70 units in total. Military victory. Survive until the following date. 450. Control 110 settlements. Defeat 20 different factions. Maintain control of 7 of all of these other things. But cultural victory, we're probably not going to do that. Divine triumph. Control 140 settlements, defeat 40 different factions either by capturing or raising their last remaining settlement or subjugate them by making them puppet states. Maintain control of 12 provinces either by direct ownership or through puppet states and military allies. And all of these guys right here. Maintain 204 units in total, construct 9 following buildings, research 40 technologies, hold at least 1 settlement in 30 provinces in which your religion is dominant. Produce the following amount of wealth from all buildings. 100,000 denarii. Okay, campaign setting. Advice? High? We'll do low. High? Okay, we'll do low. Let's do high. Limited AI movements. We'll do limited autosave to cloud, please. Thank you very much. And we'll have a battle limit of 40 minutes. I feel like we've come to terms that 60 minutes is way too long, especially for a single episode. And so we'll start the campaign here. We've already played the prologue, and I think you guys have seen that, you know, the mechanics are a little better in terms of battle. Everything's a lot more fluid. The campaign map looks amazing now. The cities actually reflect how big they are on the campaign map, so I think that's a huge plus. And then now I'm gonna shut up.
The air was filled with smoke and blood. The Roman Empire was divided. From the Pillars of Hercules to the far reaches of the Adriatic, the Western Empire stretched. Sacred earth where men of greatness conquered. But those who followed neglected Rome, fighting over the scraps of past glory. Either cast aside their petty differences or succumb to barbarous darkness. And behold, a red horse and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth. Romans of the Western Empire, those noble sons of the Eternal City, the time had come to restore power to Rome. They made ready for war. It was the will of the late Emperor Theodosius that Rome be divided. And this has left you in a precarious situation. Overstretched and desperately trying to protect the Western Empire from barbarian threat, the burden of military and civil maintenance has left your economy in tatters. Public order is waning, so it may be wise to consolidate your forces closer to the capital, ceding frontier territories as a buffer if necessary. Once your infrastructure has been strengthened and the immediate threats dealt with, you will be ready to strike forth, conquer your enemies, and if possible, regain dominion over the Eastern Roman Empire. Build a Roman Empire worthy of Augustus himself.
Mission has been issued. Preparation. They made ready for war. Survive until the following date, spring of 400, which is 5 years from now. New bonus objectives have been added, plus 2,000 treasury for surviving in the next 5 years. So that will be the current objective. So let us observe kind of what we have so far. I believe we have 69 settlements. I'm pretty sure there was a way to see
this
what.
This tab enables you to research the technology that will give you an advantage.
Okay, we already know that. So, classical philosophy? No. Let's see, we currently have molded architecture, natural philosophy, Roman ethics. Ruminate on this great empire. Your conclusions will form our future. Improve plumbing, concrete, classical philosophy, olives are expensive, make more of those, regional traditions, which will grant us additional food, or do we want the governor's estate that gives us more money from cultural buildings? Let's see. Let's check out the military as well. Skirmishers forward, harass the flanks. So you have cavalry corals, so the Comitius Spears replace Libertane Border Guards. I'm actually just going to go for economic growth for now. And then let's check the other settlements. So, we have... let's check our diplomacy. Okay, we know how to do that. So, relations towards the Romans, unfriendly, the Franks are hostile, in fact everyone on our borders is pretty pissed off at us. Yep, pretty much, and hostile, hostile, hostile. The Visigoths are hostile as well. Eastern Empire is, I would hope, friendly. Then we have hostile. Okay, so everyone outside of our borders is pretty much pissed off at us, except for this place. Military access. Well, let us see if we can.
I greet you as befits your reputation. Now, friend, can speak plainly, so that we...
marriage can be used to strengthen ties between two factions.
Hmm.
Similar to state
can't do
gifts.
Trade, huh?
It improves relations temporarily, but its positive effect lasts much longer. You can only initiate such a marriage if there are suitable family members on both sides.
Okay, so we have a non-aggression pact with these guys. I don't see any trade. Oh wait, we're already trading. Okay. But how do I tell that? Cannot trade. Just cannot trade. In fact, most of these places you can't trade. Huh. These guys you can trade with. So what we'll try and do is make as many trade offers in the first turn as we can.
I have no stomach for the meek or nice.
What do you mean I can't? Oh, there we go. What? So that's silly. So you can break a trade agreement. Oh, with a different faction if that's what you want. But I just want to do a trade.
Once agreed, a trade route is opened between your territory
okay.
and that of your trade partner, enabling goods to be traded for mutual advantage and profit. There is no limit to the number of trade routes a faction can have.
So what's nice is that there are a whole ton of different options now in the diplomacy. And we're already trading with our Eastern Roman Empire. Well, let's try the Ottomans.
Are you brave or foolish? Or just mad? Well, speak. I will listen before I turn you inside out.
I'll offer you 300 dinar. No? Okay. Well, we gave that a shot and it did not work. Alright, so now let's focus on the internal aspects of our empire. We have Colonia Agrippina.
The settlement contains both trade and military buildings. Settlements are the main consumer
okay.
of foods.
Fantastic. So you can see what kind of trade resources that this region has in each settlement. So here you can see the settlement strength is at 100%. However, sanitation and squalor are not as good because there's a chance of outbreak. Here is just 0%, so let's check where all of our armies are. I think that's a pretty important aspect of this game. So we have a force in Africa? Yes, in Africa. Constantia. We have these guys up here in England, and then, oh, would you look at that? That appears to be the Hadrian's Wall. Although, I would have liked it if they kind of named it. Like, if you, like, hover over, it would have been nice to see it. It just says Britannia Inferior. Really? No? I would have expected it to be like, oh, okay, this is a historical wall of some sort. However, they do not do that, so we really need to figure out what we want to focus on. Do we want to protect these certain borders? Do we want to abandon certain ones? We currently have... Let me check the financials really quick. So, at the moment, we actually are gaining additional monies, plus 14... Oh wait, never mind. Income next turn, 653. There you go. 653 denarii. Because our current army upkeep is ridiculous.
That's your command.
So, let's check something. This is Vettius Praetextus. He is a... Oh, these are Palatina guards. So, you notice that their uniforms don't look quite the same. And a lot of these guys are pretty much depleted, so... But they are excellent fighters, it seems.
All factions have the option to abandon their settlements, desolating the surrounding region as they go. If the enemy is getting too close, and it looks like you will lose a region, it is now possible to abandon its settlement, enacting a scorched earth policy to deny the invaders their prize. When you leave, a
Very
small
good.
Amount will be added to your treasury. Any faction that resettles or colonizes will find a ruined settlement in a region with reduced fertility, a situation which only recovers over time.
Okay, so how do we scorch earth?
The
now I'm confused.
Summary tab. Yep.
Okay. This is very important, right? So currently you can see that the political power within my faction is pretty weak. We only have 34% of the 130... Oh no, wait. We only have 34%, so 130 influence amongst the party. So acceptable. Plus one loyalty. Now, this guy is the faction leader, Flavius Honorius Augustus, who is the emperor. And you can see that there are different intrigues that you can do. You can secure his loyalty, but I mean, he's the emperor, so that seems to be silly. And then you can embezzle funds, gather support, become a retainer, master of offices, and you can assign different people to different offices. So let's say you have these other patriarchs who are, you know, from different families, and their loyalty is in question. You can get them, give them an office, and maybe that'll increase their loyalty. So right now it seems like most guys are fairly loyal until I scroll further down, in which case they are not as loyal. 6 out of 10 isn't very good. These guys, candidates, don't really know what they are at the moment. So this is the general and heir, Flavius Stiltocho. And we also have a daughter here, so if they make another baby, then that one will become the next emperor. However, at the moment, the brother will succeed the brother. Okay, in the summary, you can see the emperor here, with his sword in hand, and all the other cool stuff. So we don't have any governors at the moment,
when you
so
selected
let's
a faction,
amend that.
You also chose a family or party to represent within its political system. Your faction leader is the head of the party you chose. The influence of each party member affects its overall power. Winning battles as a general and completing construction projects as a governor may increase influence. The popularity of your party is the sum total of its members' influence versus that of the opposing party.
Very good. Okay, so the advisor speaks a lot. So we can currently assign 4 different governors. So let's give this guy Africa. I mean, is this guy actually in Africa though? Well, I guess he is now. And then you can also send, let's see, Britannia Inferior is pretty important. I would like someone to handle that. So let's say Faustus Modulus to Britannia. Oh, there's Britannia Inferior and Superior. Well, I screwed that one up, didn't I? Well, Britannia Superior. Let's see, this guy. Okay, yeah, that was actually what I was aiming for, was this part of the settlement. Although maybe London would have made more sense.
The family tree shows the relationships between members of your faction's ruling family. Family members can be made heir to the faction leadership, married or divorced. They may seek to embezzle funds for your cause or rally support for your family amongst the elite. You can spread rumors about other faction members to diminish their popularity, or carry out assassinations as you see fit. Select a character's portrait to see which options are available.
Alright, so I've chosen all of my my governors. Not the most strategic way, because I'm not entirely sure how this will affect things. But I think it might increase the amount of money and overall cost of each of the regions that they are residing over. Alright, that's great, buddy. However, we are not done yet. We still have to go to the offices and potentially give them to people. Actually, not at the moment. We do have other patricians. And I don't know if these guys are part of the family. I don't think they are, because, well, this is the family tree, right? So, very small family, only really 2 people. And we're going to have to marry this lady to someone. And we haven't even gotten to the actual Empire organization yet. So, this guy over here. Do we know how much they cost for upkeep? Because that is pretty important. And let's see. No. We do not. So over here where we can see that I think this is the upkeep cost. Yep, 155, 230. So you get the border guards, and then you have the scouts, and I believe... Let's see if the people down south hate us or not. Gaetulians do not like us, but let's see if we can trade them. Change that. Okay, no, they do not like us. So we need to consolidate, survive.
Belonging to another. The greater the squalor within a settlement, the more likely it is that a disease epidemic will take hold. Disease causes attrition and lowers public order, and can be spread to other regions via trade routes and the movement of agents or forces. Counteract squalor by constructing sanitation buildings, or by demolishing those
who increase it. There is like squalor everywhere. It's ridiculous. Everything is like a squalor building. How do I check?
This list shows.
Okay, advisor is getting a little bit annoying. All right, so none of the settlements are particularly happy except for Nona, which is one of the provinces, and they are. Why are they happy? I don't know. But let's focus on the unhappy settlements from the bottom. So squalor plus 2, squalor plus 1, but we do need the fishing wharf, so that will be necessary. And then over here we're going to... I feel like nothing you build will be of any good. But let's expand that and see if we can fix something. Like, let's see if... Okay, so plus 2 sanitation. Oh, if you build a fountain. Minus 100% public order plus... Alright, so let's do a Latin baptistry.
Troops can be stationed inside a settlement to defend it in the event of attack. Whilst there, they will also act as a deterrent to any rebellious tendencies amongst the population.
Public order plus 3, plus 7. We also have to watch out for the food, because that will be a huge thing that will destroy us if we don't be careful.
Although food is automatically distributed across your territory, if total consumption is not matched by production, then food shortages can occur, which can lead to unrest and ultimately rebellion. Make sure you keep food production buildings upgraded.
I think we're gonna have to build a lot of Latin baptistries to improve the disorder of each settlement. And then if we click on the building browser, you can kind of see the types of buildings you can build and also what level you can get them to. Okay, get rid of that. So now we are out of cash, and I know that a lot of these forces will probably not be used, and if we do use them, we'll have to abandon. They'll probably get crushed, I guess, is the problem. Require of me. So borders, this guy over here, how do I disband the force? Let me click on recruit units. Okay, wrong button. Cannot disband that guy, but maybe I can disband everyone else. I can't do that. Wow, generals are expensive. Indeed they are. Yeah, there's really no option to disband like a whole army, I guess. But we don't particularly need the cohorts. And I guess I'll disband those guys. We're in desperate need of money. And I guess I'll keep the light cavalry and light skirmishers.
For battle.
Those guys are Alright, it's just sitting here at the frontier. Got some spears, 260. The cohorts. And then we have onagers. So if we were to attack a settlement right now, we could probably use them for something. But I don't think we will be. Alright, these guys are... I mean, these are definitely excellent soldiers, but we just can't afford anything right now. And these guys are also very depleted. So how can I... merge selected units? Oh, wow! That's a new feature! Yeah, too bad they're all getting blown away. Still 155. Over here, Scott Equites. Let's send this guy over here.
Commander.
And then I'm gonna have this guy join up with this force.
Merge armies or fleets in order to assemble the strongest possible force. Click on the unit you wish to move, then click on the tick button to move it from one force to another. It is possible to select several units at a time. Note,
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Moving everything into one force will leave one general or admiral without any troops or ships.
Beginning yeah. Journey for Rome. Oh wow! How come I can't pass this guy over?
Ready for orders. At your command.
Oh, okay, I can. I just in order to move somehow the missed that force, completely.
Make sure a general is present. Select the settlement or the general.
Ah, now right I can expand this general. You wish to move to.
When you release the
and then what happens then?
The army will walk to the chosen spot.
Okay, so we can always reinstate it later. So I guess you have to disband everyone before you can disband the general. Okay, so that means the army over here. I'll just do this. Disband everyone here. There you go. That makes more sense. I guess they thought maybe people might accidentally disband their whole army and then bad things will happen.
We hunger for
okay.
Some. What does Rome require of me?
Let's see. Well, I guess for now I can merge these guys here, and that'll reduce some of our costs, but not actually get rid of everyone.
How can I serve the people of Rome?
And then this is the biggest army here. These guys I want to use for potential conquest. And in Africa, I'm a little skeptical about the guys over here. However, I think I will end the turn here to just see kind of if we did any correct moves after I figure out where Rome is and potentially upgrade something or absolutely nothing. But Rome is also very... although they're okay happy. Let's see if I can... oh, I don't have enough money. That's not good. But I'll add some fields for some food, because I think we are lacking in that aspect. And I'll enter my turn here. You may still edict issue an edict. So Africa is particularly unhappy. So we want something that will reduce that unhappiness and also increase production. So bread and circuses for everyone. The next one, another edict. This place is also unhappy. So what do we go for? We will increase the Christian mission. And then what's really nice is, you know, when you end your turn you can actually select the objectives that you need. And I think the Christian mission will improve the civic unhappiness here. In Liguria. Oh, it's because we have four governors who can issue such edicts. And over here I will do... oh, these guys are already happy, so I can do... religious influence minus 4 non-Latin Christianity? I'll do the Christian mission for the sake of it. Alright. So we have very cheap labor, the Saxons are moving, and they are attacking.
The balance of units and the general's ability are important factors also. Look at the strength ratio.
Alright, let's fight this battle. We already know that this is a long shot, but what if we win? And the chances are probably not, because they have a fair number of missile troops, and it looks like they have some heavy troops as well. And most of these guys are garrison forces. So we will slowly watch the Empire crumble, but also we will slowly regain its strength. At least that is my hope. You can see that they're actually attacking by ship. My army is right there. And you'll notice that the settlements are a lot more well-defined. Town center is the point you need to defend, and it actually makes sense where it is. But what's new is that you can have barricades within your settlement. So let's say if they were to concentrate their forces this way, it would make a lot of sense to build a barricade right here. But unfortunately, you can only build one barricade at the moment, and that I'm pretty sure that depends on several factors, like how big your city is, how much resources you have, and probably some other criteria I am not mentioning at the moment. I don't have any archers, so I shall start the battle.
Your missile units by attacking the rear or right-hand side of their targets, away from their shields and armor. Once the enemy is waiting.
And so we are on a ship now, sailing away. Can you see the enemy?
So we stand, we hold, to arms.
Okay. This is actually a naval ship, so these are just light transports for their forces. And you'll notice that the buttons are a little smaller, the mini-map isn't as pronounced as it used to be. I mean, it's very small here. You can also toggle the tactical map to see the overview of the actual battle. And here, settlement damage, how much time is remaining. The forces, ooh, they actually show you the force count of the actual number of units. And here, we'll see if we can destroy the light spearmen. And this is actually a boarding. I thought they were gonna shoot, but I guess not. You notice the camera's a lot smoother, it doesn't jump and hover like it used to when it touches a ship. It's just kinda nice and smooth as we kill off all of these guys over here. These guys are just
speed controls are used to adjust.
Sailing away. And you notice there's not a lot of noticeable lag when I hit, you know, triple fast forward. And these guys are still scrolling along very nicely. One of the things you'll probably notice if these guys have stopped is that there are actually women in the Nordic bands. So that's very cool. I'm glad they diversified it, because a lot of the times back in the day, you know, everyone fights, and there was the wives would fight if they could hold a sword, you know, all that coolness. Alright. Defensive testudo. And then defensive testudo, shields ready. It just basically gives us plus 15 attack against elephants, plus 50% missile block chance. So let's get ready. Let's get our men ready and in position. And these guys can also fire at will. So I think that's a huge bonus. Before there was, you know, talks about not being able to fire at will for your, for really just javelins or whatever the Romans held in their hands. I think they were called javelins, but oh no, they were called pilas. Heavy melee infantry that can throw their javelins or pila as much as they wanted. And then you'll notice that the defensive testudo looks pretty awesome. Not as awesome as it used to because they are no longer using rectangular shields, but I'll take it. And it's much easier to move the camera, as I've said many times, but man, this is so much better! Although, to be fair, I've been playing Medieval 2, and that camera is just a nightmare. I can't scroll up, scroll down. This is a welcome change. That is all I am saying. Sons of Rome, get ready to destroy your enemy. Got my light melee cavalry engaged in combat here. The enemy unit is losing. They are enemy skirmishers, so we should have no trouble with them. But perhaps I should move back a little and then come back and kill them. Oh, no, that was a bad decision. Although now I know, never to disengage. At least not like that. So we do have toggle fire at will, but... Alright, so we've crushed those guys, and let's continue breaking them. We may be few on soldiers, but if we can crush our enemy as they are routing, then we should definitely try to do so, so that they don't come back from routing. Alright, so we want to avoid the brigands over here. Alright, so we're at 50% for the cavalry. We're also attacked in the rear by those dudes. And now the main force is coming up, so I'm going to try and scoot... Nope, I can't. Alright, so here's the trouble with my cavalry. They're gonna run into their soldiers. But when I'm controlling these guys, I don't feel like they're not responsive. The guys feel like they are responding to your commands, and I feel like that's very important. Considering that that wasn't always the case in really a lot of the other Total War games. Especially Medieval. I mean, that was, ugh, nightmare. But Medieval 2 is also a very long time ago, so I can't blame them for having unresponsive AI. So this barricade is very useful because, well, because it basically stops them from... Oh jeez, no! Now they're completely routed. However, you'll notice that these towers, and I love what they've done with it, is when an enemy captures an arrow tower, it actually gets burnt down, which finally makes so much more sense. Like, why would you capture a tower only to have it be used by the enemy? They should just burn it down. Because it's basically like free men on the map. They're controlled by the AI. It's basically like a turret that you get for free.
Fire! The settlement is on fire!
Oh, yes indeed it is. I'm getting these guys over here. That guy has a interesting shield. Why is he the only one that gets the yellow one? Everyone else gets, like, the standard Roman shield. Oh, he's the flag bearer. He needs a smaller shield because, you know, he's holding the flag. It's kinda heavy. Losing current combat. Publius! Aquilus, for the Libertani border guards are failing! plus 15 attack against elephants. This is engaged as defensive testudo. And look how smooth that was. It didn't feel like it was like going kind of awkwardly going, hey, I can't do this anymore. Peace out, dude. Alright, so they looks like they destroyed the barricades with their fists. Oh wait, it's over here. They have not destroyed it with their fists yet, but I'm sure they will soon.
Orders understood.
Okay, let's see, if I hold Alt, nope. Oh wait, Alt is over here. Come on, throw something. No! They refuse to throw, but what's nice is they are getting shot by my arrow tower. Oh, another huge thing that I really like about this game. Guess what? People live in these settlements! You have your farmers out here just chilling, just walking around, idling, and you're just going, what is going on? Well, these guys are just enjoying the battle and not dying. And that's really it. They're not dying right now. Alright, I don't know what they're doing. I'm gonna let them do their thing over there, but I am going to help my comrades over here. So we'll probably get overrun very soon, but you know, we had to at least give it a shot. It's very possible that we might need to disband the army in Britannia and also the governor that's there. Losing Britannia is not a huge loss. I'd rather not lose it, but it seems like with these guys attacking, I will not have an army big enough to stop it. And these guys are holding pretty well. You also notice that the battles are a little bit longer. So I'm gonna charge, go in there, give them some help. However, we will fast forward as... I mean... Yeah, look at that. This is gonna take a while. Unless... Oh, what's going on? We're gonna fend off a barbarian attack with our legionnaires, our cohorts in this case.
The men are broken and running for their lives.
The men are broken and running for their lives. You cowards! Oh, whoops. Alright, we need to push. And we need to push fast, otherwise we will lose the morale advantage of breaking their men. And also we get to kill all of these archers, which may prove invaluable later. Oh, what? Moving? What? That's lame. Although I guess I can't blame them. Alright, they're back. They've unrouted themselves instantly. And we are about to lose the town hall, or town center in this case. Let's see, over here, we're killing all the nomadic bows, Nordic bows. Alright, let's fast forward. The battle is tough, but let's take as many of them as we can with us. These 69, 67, 65 dead Romans. Oh, they're all gonna die. See, this is why they need to fight to the death. They're exhausted. That's kind of the one thing I guess they never fixes. They didn't add fighting to the death. Because if there's no way to run, I mean, it's pretty obvious that... Oh, Snapples! My fleet actually won, but I fear it is much too late. I fear it is much too late. As there's nowhere to land. Although what's weird is... Oh no! I could probably still keep this town if I just kept this ship hovering. But let's not do that.
The men's resolve is our men flee the field of battle.
Okay. Never mind. Alright. So that's not broken. Great. We've only killed... So we killed 997 men of the Saxons. So we basically destroyed half of their forces of 624 men. Okay, so they didn't actually end up taking it. That was just a raid where they killed all my men. But we still keep the settlement, which means we might get some tax income from that. From the farmers that decided not to flee.
Single force. A faction can field a maximum of 40 units at one time.
Okay. However, we're at the 50-minute. Well, we're at the 48-minute mark, and I kind of want to keep these episodes short. And by short, I really mean like 20 to 30 minutes, at least for this series. But since this is the first episode, I wanted to get into a battle. And you know, we've gotten to the battle, kind of shown the campaign map. So I think we'll leave this battle for the next video. So I would like to thank you guys all for watching, and I'll see you next time.